us start this off as we are doing now by saying, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit. Exactly as God created me to be, I am not a body. I have never been a body, and I will never be a body, all right? Ultimately, the fact is bodies don't even exist, truly. In fact, existence doesn't exist. This is a fact. What we call nature existence doesn't exist. Existence doesn't exist. This is existence doesn't exist. Existence doesn't exist. Let there be light, let there be light, let there be light, let there be light. Now, we're going to keep on using every moment possible right now to keep moving our comfort zone. We talk about non-dual, non-duality, non-duality, non-duality. Well, what is duality? Duality is to say, for instance, that truth is what happens when lies are defeated. Or truth is what happens when lies are no more. Our truth is the absence of lies. See, this is duality. Non-duality, say, just truth is true and nothing else is true. Truth has no opposite. Duality will say, well, lies are the opposite of truth. That is not true. That is not true. Truth has no opposite. So non-duality was, it says truth has no opposite. Truth has no opposite. Reality has no opposite. Reality has no need for some opposition to be defeated, to be triumphed over, to be destroyed, to be fixed, to be gotten rid of, to be excluded, to be changed, to be absent. It has no need whatsoever. This is non-duality. So we're moving our comfort zone into non-duality. So it's into meaning it's already the case, but we're accepting that non-duality is and nothing else is. And the more we do that, the easier it gets. And I certainly understand that it's not easy because it hasn't been easy for me at all. Taken me a lifetime of struggling. I can't get it, don't understand it. What? But it's the more our comfort zone moves into the non-dual abidance, the less we need confusion. We don't really need confusion. We don't really need confusion, and so since we don't need it, it doesn't arise. Our attention simply doesn't need it. Now we think that the way stuff goes here is that something arises and then our attention says, look at that. No, first there's a desire for our attention to be distracted, and then the situation arises. It's kind of like that. Or you might even say it's concurrent. Reality's concurrent. Simultaneous, spontaneous, deity, arising, subsiding, non-arising, non-subsiding, all concurrent, spontaneous. So again, non-duality, to use an example, is truth is true and nothing else is true. And duality is to say that truth, the lies are the opposite of truth. It's not true. That is duality. It's not true at all. Truth has no opposite. So when you hear about the teachings that say, well, you need to defeat darkness, you need to defeat lies, we need to purify, and we need to, fix and change and adapt, and all of these teachings throughout history. Now, those are all dualistic teachings. And it's not true at all. None of those will lead you to non-duality. Now here we do accept the fact that we have one problem, which is the continuity problem. And this is a practical matter, okay? It doesn't mean there's a problem with reality. It means that we because we've been trying to change what we are, we have a continuity problem. We're afraid of our own perfection. We're afraid of what we are. So we say, well, so we have to move our comfort zone gradually. So we do admit to this just one problem, but no other problem. Okay, none other. It's a practical issue that we have to dissolve. That's the only thing we have to do. In terms of doing anything, all we have to do is evaporate this continuity problem. All we have to do is move our comfort zone. That's it. Because reality is already non-dual. It's always non-dual. It is. Reality is. With no opposite. No opposite. We do not have to defeat anything. We just have to evaporate our continuity concern, our continuity fear. This issue of duality is very slippery, and I've struggled with it my entire life. Because when the continuity fear kicks in, suddenly you become dualistic and you can't understand it. But the more you evaporate the continuity fear, the easier it becomes. You say, oh yeah, I get it. Sort of. But again, moving one's comfort zone is a general thing, general situation. So we stay away from details and labels and stuff like that. It's because as you move your comfort zone, it's you're getting more comfortable with the totality of the situation. It's a comfort zone means the totality of the situation. So when you've moved your comfort zone quite a bit, you realize that, wow, I'm just more comfortable with all of this clarification, all of it. Just the whole thing, the whole situation seems easier. That's the result of moving the comfort zone, rather than academic, trying to, you know, get academic labels and words and get those all arranged in a certain way. That's not the path at all. That's not the spiritual path. Spiritual path is all about moving your comfort zone, where you have this total feeling of like belonging more and more. Oh, I belong here. It all feels like I belong here. This is my home. And you gradually move this home more and more into acceptance that there's nothing that needs to be defeated. There's nothing that needs to be changed. Nothing needs to be fixed or altered, smoothed out, terminated. There's no opposite to look away from, to struggle with. There's nowhere to fall. You can't fall anywhere, actually. Where can everywhere fall to? Or even beyond everywhere, where can isness fall? How can isness fall? And so there's it's like a dawning, really. The path is more like a dawning. When the dawn comes, everything is tinged with light. Everything is tinged with light. You don't obsess about, oh, look at that leaf. I see some light on that leaf. Let me name this leaf. Let me photograph it. Let me study it. No, the entire landscape is tinged with the dawn. And so you just experience the totality of the dawning, the totality of it. That's why we sit quietly. Don't describe, don't label, don't obsess, don't struggle. Okay, so, and we're working in every video, we work towards this spiritual buzz of the burn, we call it, where you feel like, wow, I've really moved my comfort zone to the point where I'm feeling pretty jittery. Okay, this is what we go for. Otherwise, we've pretty much wasted our time. So always try and move yourself into where you feel the sort of fundamental jitteriness, this nameless jitteriness, not anxiety, more a jitteriness like, wow, I just moved, I'm sort of in new territory, that kind of feeling, like, feel a little uneasy about this territory. I started to feel jittery, reverberating. And then you just be quiet and relax and just calmly sit. And just your attention, your awareness will automatically, gradually accommodate you to the situation. Without thinking. It's deeper than thinking, actually. Deeper than concepts. Because it has to do with recognizing we don't need concepts. So don't struggle with concepts. The concept of we don't need concepts, don't struggle with it, because the getting used to this, the comfort, is beyond concepts, actually. So your task on the spiritual path as a pilgrim is to keep pushing your buttons. The ability to push your buttons, to move your comfort zone, so you get this jitteriness, like, wow. You know, swim a little farther out from the shore kind of thing, situation. Like, whoa, I'm a little bit further out. Like that. First we put a toe in the water, then we wade, then we get a little deeper. Gradually, you get a little farther from shore. You get out into deeper water, floating there, and you say, wow, a little bit more. It's a good analogy, because even the best swimmer, there's some point they look into shore and they say, whoa, I think I'm a little bit farther out than I'm used to. And that'll get to you. Being a swimmer and a surfer, when I was younger, I know exactly, you know, how this is you can paddle out from shore a certain distance and you feel comfortable. If you start going out further, you get this sort of queasy uneasiness, like, you know, it's weird. And they get, if you get used to being a little further, then it doesn't arise, but then you go a little further, and again, say, whoa, wait a minute, I'm out in the kelp beds here, and I feel like I'm, you know, a little too far away from shore. That's a very good analogy if you happen to be a swimmer or something, like the ocean or something. It's very similar to that, where you may just be 20 feet further, and you think, this is stupid, you know, but don't argue with it, don't struggle with it. Honor the situation, because we have a very severe fear here of perfection. So recognize it. You say, okay, I'm on my surfboard. I paddled out a little farther than I'm used to, and say, oh my gosh, I'm sort of shaking and trembling. Just say, okay, continuity fear. That's great. Let me stop right here then. You know, don't go too much further. Just okay, stop. Just look around, you know, and just get used to where you are. It may take a while. You see, we're impatient, so we try to intellectually say, well, we, you know, argue ourselves into it. Yeah, you should be fine, no problem. No, that's not the way to go. Give yourself time, give yourself 10 minutes, give yourself 20 minutes, give yourself an hour. Move around a little bit. Let yourself get very used to it. And maybe next day, do it again and again, every day. Get a little further out. Even now, thinking about that, I get nervous. Yeah, absolutely. So this is not an intellectual accomplishment at all. And of course, there are people who are in a big hurry, and they will just try to argue and do, you should be fine, what are you talking about? You're only 20 feet more feet out before. Yeah, don't worry about it. Everything's fine, blah, blah, blah. No, that's not helpful at all. That just causes you to be dishonest with how you feel, and it's going to lead you into troubles. So be very aware of when you're starting to, you know, feel jittery, and say, okay, recognize it. And say, okay, this is what we're working on. Working on getting into this jitteriness, staggered mindness. The mind is kind of staggered, like, wow, this is a little farther out than I'm used to going. No deals, don't make any deals at all. Don't get anybody else to try to take care of it. You have to face it. Have to face it. No. Of course, we've had trouble with this throughout history. All sorts of tricky strategies have been used that don't work. Get a codependent relationship. Look for some guru to take care of it for you. Try to all sorts of bargains and deals, and that'll never work. That'll never work. You simply have to realize that you can do it if you're just patient. Patience pays off. You have to have the mixture of the intense, drive to do it, and then the patience. To be patient and persevere is a combination of those factors. You have to have the icebreaker mentality, because you have to push your buttons, sit down, okay, I gotta push my buttons, gotta do it. And then also the patience, so there's both of those. Sort of if you want to talk about it from standpoint of male, female energies, or it's like both are being used. Both are being used. Neither one dominating. But that's just one way of talking about it. I don't really think about it in those terms, but some people might. But it's probably best not to. It's just be patient. Don't make excuses, don't make deals. No deals. Just remind yourself, I'm not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me to be. I am breathless awareness. I am is breathless awareness. So what I'm doing, I'm showcasing the path, is I'm looking for what buttons to push now. How do I move my comfort zone? You see, how do I move it forward so I start feeling jittery? And so I'm just patient, sitting patiently, expecting that, it's going to happen. Invariably it works. It's like a miracle, really. All right, so trust in this. Of course, you have to be ready. You have to really want it. And you can always trick yourself and not be honest about it. You're too frightened. No, but if you really say, I'm just going to sit here quietly, and almost always, maybe even always, some breakthrough will come up. And you just say, wow, I'm glad I sat here quietly. Sometimes it takes, quite a commitment. But hey, what else is our existence for? Actually, what else is non-existence for? Since existence doesn't exist, what are we doing? Well, we're entertaining the idea of non-existence. That doesn't exist either. It's just a dream. It's a wishful thinking. Jesus said it's wishful thinking. That's true. Oh, I wish I could change what I am. That's all idle. Idle wishful thinking, idle thoughts, idle wishful thinking, whimsicality. Just like that cat. The cat makes a mad dash across the yard, and there's a tree, and says, oh, what the heck? I think, let me go up this tree. And it impulsively runs up the tree and says, uh-oh. Looks down and says, oh my gosh, what am I going to do now? It says, maybe I better go higher. So it climbs up higher, thinking that'll solve the problem. It looks down and says, I'm even farther off the ground now. Says, wow, I got a worse problem. And it thinks, well, let me shake up a little higher. And then it says, nah, I don't know if that's all. And then it looks down and says, oh boy, somehow I've got to get down from that tree. Now this cat is very smart, and it figured out how to get down from trees. That's what we got to be like that too, because we had this whimsical idea of changing what we are. And now we've got this severe continuity problem. I'm afraid to let go of this silly dream. So what the cat does, as you're going down the tree, your claws, what this cat does, is it twists its rear, it's a very slender cat, and it twists its rear, its back half around, so that the claws are as if they were going up the tree. and then its front paws are steering itself down, so it drags itself to creak down the tree with its claws acting as a brake, the two claws on its rear two legs digging into the tree, and it sort of slides down the tree that way. Very, very clever way. Now if you're a fatter cat, you can't do that. And then as the fat cats get stuck, you see the fat cats get stuck. This cat is very slender, thin, slender, lightweight. It's able to twist its body around very sort of sideways. It goes down side. It's really something. Very smart. So we're like that. We got to be the smart cats, not the fat cats. All right? Don't berate yourself because you're not a fat cat. Applaud yourself because you're a super smart cat. Now, see, this cat is not going to leap from the top of the tree, so it's got to go down gradually, slide down gradually, just like us. We're not going to leap into the perfection, into the formless perfection that is, into acceptance of it. We're going to gradually slide down, slide down, and then say, okay, we're real close to the ground. Maybe we can now just kind of take a little leap of faith. We're going to do it that way, for sure. For sure. And you get those cats way up, fat cats way in the top of the tree, and they look around and say, I got no problem. I'm just enjoying it up here. Easy to get down. I just, you know, jump down at some point. It's not a problem. And you look later, and they're still up there in the tree. Now they're like seeing, it's getting dark. Kind of worried. They're not so happy. You see all these fat cats up on the top of the trees. They're partying. They're happy. So, oh man, this is great. Later on, they're getting concerned. Wow. Yeah. Gotta get down. How am I gonna get down? I'm thinking. They start singing a different tune. So don't worry about the world laughing, thinking you're not, you know, wasting your time. They'll be singing a different tune. They'll get buyer's remorse. They'll get cat in the tree concern. How am I going to get down? I can't jump down. That's too far. See, this is the realization that hits everyone. I was up in the top of the tree, and I said, okay, I'm done with this. Okay, now I need to jump down to the ground. I look, and I said, whoa, that's too far. You know, that's too far. Oh, my gosh, I didn't realize I was so far away from it. Dread arose, you know, because I was all ready to leap. And suddenly I realized, oh my gosh, it seems like it's too great of a leap. And that hits like a massive tsunami of dread. It's really as frightening as a huge tsunami coming. You're on a beach and this huge tsunami is sweeping towards you. Massive wall of water coming in, and you just say, uh-oh. And you know, it's like that. The dread is just horrible because you really want to leap. You're done with this, and then you're ready to go. And the last second you say, oh my gosh, it's too much. The shock hits you like that shock wave. You say, oh my God, I almost leaped. Freaks you out. And you become frightened of yourself at that point. And then you lose your confidence. This is what happens. Okay, having been there and done that, I used to be a super confident person. Having had many incarnations in this world and having reached a point of very high acclaim and confidence, people thought I was the most confident person in the world. And nothing fazed me, on top of the world. So I was way up high in the tree, and then I decided, I'm finished with this. This is enough. I want to go back to formless spirit. And so now I'm going to jump, and just whoa, can't do it, too scared. And at that point, I lost all my confidence, never to regain it actually. And it's a terrible thing. You thought, I should be able to regain it. I've never had any problem with confidence. Nothing fazes me. So I just had this experience, and it's not a big deal. But So then I tried to function confidently, and I couldn't. I couldn't function confidently anymore because the desire to do what I wanted, really wanted to do, I suddenly realized I couldn't do it. And then that reverberated throughout my whole psyche. So whatever I wanted to do, I said, well, wait, whoa, that might lead to this jumping, you know. So what happens is you get up to the top of the world. You know, you're on top of the world. I was on top of the world, actually. Had everything. And this experience then hit me. And lost all my confidence. Yeah, that's the worst experience of all. It's the worst ever. Nothing worse. And you go from this person that people think is like Superman to someone, you know, sitting in your locked in a bedroom, trembling in fear, biting your fingernails and sweating with anxiety and fear, unable to function, social phobias, depression, can't sleep. And you're just completely mortified. Completely mortified. This, how could this happen to me? You know, how could this happen? And you have no idea. You think you just don't know what happened. And you just can't figure it out. And you know, it's beyond suicidal. You just can't believe it. Well, you know, what happened to me? And nobody knows. Nobody else can understand or, you know, it's just, no one has a clue what to do. This is what happened to me. And this, I know this is what happens in this world. So I certainly have the utmost compassion for everybody here, knowing what happens. And so the sharing here is very important, not just for me, but for everyone. Because this is a universal struggle that happens. And it's super important to recognize that it's a continuity fear. If I hadn't had Jesus come along, I don't think I would have made it. Because Jesus gradually helped me see that I was dealing with a continuity issue. He said, you can't just leap. He says, extremely rare that anyone ever leaves. So rare we don't even have to even talk about it. No one's going to leave. Forget about it. Okay. He says it's an illusion. If you leap, actually, you find that there is no distance at all. You know, none. But you won't believe it. You know, your belief system. So he said you have to exchange belief systems. You have to do it that way. And so I understood that it was a continuity issue. And plus, I had this experience of awakening and seeing then going back into the fear. And I realized it was only a continuity issue. That's it. And that saved me. Absolutely saved me. So this is what I am sharing with the world. And if the more you get this, the better it will be for you. For sure. For sure. You begin to forgive yourself. You begin to recognize what happened. You will recognize I only have a continuity fear, and then your practice will be condensed and your attention will be on the right practice, and then you'll start making progress, and then you'll say, wow, maybe I'm going to get out of this hell I've been in. So pretty much all go through this. I mean, there have been many illustrious people throughout history, those who thought they were on top of the world, all right? And then it can happen to them. It can happen to anyone. It will eventually. The fat cat's high on a tree, way up there, thinking that they've got it made. Everybody's looking up at them. And then they realize, hey, I don't want to be up here anymore. Okay, how do I get down? Oh, I'll just jump. I can do anything, you know. I'll just jump. Everybody says, how are you going to get down? Oh, me? What are you talking about? I can do anything. I'll just jump. Not a problem. And then you start to ready to jump and oh, can't do it. You know, oh. You try, you can't do it. And it just completely, it's like a house of cards falling down. You realize all your confidence, like a house of cards, it all collapses. And then you end up collapsed. And you go from top of the world to the bottom of the world. And again, this is, I understand how horrible this is for sure. And so I certainly don't minimize it. When I say do right practice, I'm not minimizing the difficulty that people are in at all. Not at all. But I understand that I got out, I've worked through it because adamant advice from Jesus. Adamant advice. Great example from Sri Sri Anandamayama. And then great reassurance from Amana Maharshi. And then great clarification from Longchenpa. So various teachers, you know, have helped me out. Because they certainly know, you know, what the problem is for sure. Now, it's way better if you have a culture which does not give rise to heroes, the heroic, you know, all that. There's a humble, meek, repentant culture that's very helpful, because maybe you'll be able to avoid the extremes. But on the other hand, having reached this extreme, it caused extreme motivation. It's like my whole life since this happened has been like a tsunami is right behind me. Some 25 foot wall of water is right behind me. If I turn back, I'm going to be engulfed by it. So this is the kind of motivation. I don't even look back. Don't look back. Just run as fast as possible. So it's good motivation. But the Western, the world tends to give rise to looks for very confident people trying to look, you know, trying to build up our self-esteem, build up our confidence, feeling like we can solve all problems, or world beaters. And so you build up this personality complex of belief that you're supposed to be this way. And so you feel you can beat any problem. So you feel you should be able to just leap from the top of the tree, you know, leap from this belief in imperfection into timeless isness, perfect isness. And then you can't do it. And then that collapses the personality complex, you know, and you end up losing. I still don't have my confidence. I've never been able to recover it. Humpty Dumpty. So now all I have is just discipline, perseverance, patience, right practice, spiritual path. That's all I've got. But I don't have social confidence anymore. It's never returned. Don't have the kind of work confidence, just general world confidence. I don't have it. You know, it's never returned. But what I do have is confidence that I'm going to be free of death, free of existence. I do have confidence in that. I have assurance that it will happen at some point. Holy Spirit assured me, Ramana Maharshi assured me. I'm sure my teachers are helping me out and know that's true. That's not the same as social confidence. Not at all. Not at all. It's different. It's really flipping the cosmic script. Realizing I've never been in a cosmos. Nobody's in a cosmos. Again, do not get entangled in anything too concrete or specific. Just get a holistic feeling. Flip the cosmic script. I don't need a cosmic script. So this is what you're going towards, is a realization we don't need a cosmic script. Reality doesn't need a script. The cosmos is a script. We don't need a script. Reality is unscripted. Okay? Reality is unscripted. All praise to Jesus Christ, who says God is not an architect of universes. Reality is perfect freedom. It's unscripted, indeterminate. Which means each instant reflects perfectly whatever it is we want to experience. And that can go in any direction whatsoever, always pure potentiality. Never is potentiality vitiated in the slightest bit. We could create innumerable universes, cosmoses. It wouldn't change pure potential in the slightest bit. Destroy souls, and we have to defeat this, you know, this Manichaeism, Zoroastrianism. I won't say Judaism exactly, because there's a high tradition in Judaism that is non-dual, I believe. On the surface, all teachings are, you know, dualistic in this world, it seems like, right? Yeah. But anyway, we're not trying to defeat anything. We're not trying to destroy. We're not trying to bring light to darkness. We're not trying to get rid of the snake. It's just a rope. There's no snake. We don't have to get rid of it. We don't need the absence of a snake for a rope to be a rope. Okay, the guy, someone's walking along the path, the pilgrimess walking along the path. Oh my God, a snake? It's just a rope. Do they have to get rid of the snake? Do they need the absence of a snake in order to realize it's a rope? Say, okay, there's an absence. The snake is absent from the rope. It was never there. There's no need for an absence of the snake. Don't need to defeat the snake. Don't need to turn the snake into a rope. So you can work on duality this way. Don't worry if it doesn't. Just keep, you know, this. Just let it percolate. Because our continuity fear needs confusion. So it will throw up confusion. Don't worry about it. You just keep evaporating it. Every day, keep working on it, evaporating it. And, gradually, you won't need as much confusion. Don't struggle with the struggle. Don't struggle with the confusion. Just say, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Nothing has changed in the slightest bit. So as the comfort zone moves, eventually you'll move in and you'll feel entirely comfortable with this. And then you just have this overall comfort zone with the entire situation here. Then you'll be, you know, effectual help, reassurance to many, probably. But my experience in this world is everybody has a severe continuity problem. And there are some few that may have worked, evaporated a lot of it, you know. But very few have evaporated all of it. Occasionally that happens. But by and large, everyone has a very severe continuity problem. So this kicks up tremendous dust, tremendous confusion. And we'll continue to kick it up. There's nothing you can do except evaporate the continuity fear. You can't stop yourself from kicking up confusion. If you're afraid, you will do that. So the only way to do is to lessen the fear. Don't work on the dust directly. Dust all the time. Terrible dust, nastiest stuff. In my face, dust on. And I just ignore it. Pretty much ignore it. Just keep working on the continuity fear. If you start obsessing about dust, you'll never get there. If you start obsessing about confusion, that's the worst. Don't struggle with the struggle. Don't struggle with the confusion. The confusion will tempt you to struggle with it. This is the temptation you must avoid. Do not struggle with the struggle. Do not try to conquer the confusion. Do not try to defeat the confusion. Reality has no opposite. Reality has no opposite. There's no need to defeat anything, destroy anything, exterminate anything. Don't try to kill the ego. Don't try to get rid of the ego. Don't do anything to the ego. Don't struggle with the ego. Just keep working on the continuity fear, and eventually you won't need the ego. You simply won't need it. Because all of this confusion is just silly. All of this confusion is just silly. The more we struggle with it, the more confused we get. Why am I struggling with this silliness? That's ridiculous. Then you get even more confused. it snowballs, doesn't it? This is the difficulty, you know. So this is why I'm emphasizing. I know where the difficulty is. Do not struggle with the struggle. You must discipline yourself. Do not try. Do not get in competition with anyone, intellectual competition with anyone. Then you will start snowballing in the wrong direction. Don't try to be too bright or too brilliant or too smart, too informed, or anything like that. Don't struggle with the confusion. Often those who have a very severe continuity fear try to induce others to struggle with the confusion so that they snowballs on them and they end up very, very confused. And they say, you see, I'm you know better than I am, so I don't... You know, I don't have to take any path. Misery loves company, right? So those who are really struggling with fear tend to be that way. So what I did was I kind of removed myself from society, most part, and stayed away from all that through long misery of that kind of situation. Wow, it's hard, super hard lessons. The school of hard knocks. Don't analyze the confusion. Don't struggle with it. It's futile. It makes it worse. Just admit, I have a severe continuity problem. That's it. See, once you admit that, you don't have to struggle with the confusion anymore. You know it's just a severe continuity problem. It's just the expression of your continuity fear. That's all. And so if you know how to work on your continuity fear, basically evaporate it as we're doing, move your comfort zone, you realize it will dissipate. It will dissipate. Without me directly struggling with it, wrestling with it. But I don't have some sort of brilliant, you know, explanation for it all. But stay away from brilliant people who are demanding brilliant explanations and intellectual competition, or don't get seduced into that. Say, no, forget it. I only have one problem. That's a very severe problem, and so I don't really have anything to say about it. Except to slowly move my comfort zone. It's so severe, I really have to work at it from just, you know, quietness. Just say that. I have to, you know, work on it through quietness. Sort of imperceptibly letting it evaporate. And of course, other people will say, oh no, I have a faster way for you. I can just talk my way out of it. Yeah, no, you cannot. It's way too severe for that. It's the rabbit and the hare. The hare will brag, 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 you know. Now stay away from the hares. Jump, jump, jump. Go. Just be the tortoise and go relentlessly. Slowly but relentlessly. Again, you cannot conquer your confusion. You cannot conquer your confusion. You cannot defeat your fears. Do not allow yourself, stay away from that mood and attitude which is so prevalent in the world of, hey, we can help you defeat your fears. We can help you conquer. We can help build up your self-esteem. We can build your confidence up. No, you cannot. Stay meek, humble, unassuming, repentant. You are not a conqueror. You are not here to defeat the ego. You're here to evaporate the continuity fear, here to move your comfort zone day after day after day. Not a business person, you know, no deals, there are no deals, no exceptions, no exemptions, no deals. There's absolutely no deal to make with perfection in terms of perfection. Perfection doesn't have an opposite. There is nothing that perfection can make a deal with. Now the Holy Spirit has a pragmatic mission where it can use the prop of supernature for us, absolutely. But that's still not a deal with perfection. It is not. There is no deals that can be made with perfection. You could say it's a reflection of perception, but it's not a deal at all. So many business-minded people pretending to be so confident, they're offering you deals. They say, hey, what about this deal? You can do it this way, do it this way. No. No deals. I had an interesting experience in a previous life where, as a young person, being a musician, pianist, I had like the best teacher, one of the best teachers there was in all of Europe. And the teacher said, look, this is how you have to do it. You want to be really top-notch, this is how you have to do it. So I said, okay. And trusted, had faith in the teacher, and told me what to do. And so I did it, and it worked. And same thing on the spiritual path. You get a top-notch teacher like Jesus, listen to what he says, do what he suggests as much as possible. Now, you may not always do what he suggests, but you'll come back around to it. You know, give him the benefit of the doubt. Sure, there will be doubts, but give him the benefit of the doubt. Practice, practice, practice. It's a comfort zone thing. It's not a business deal. It's not some deal you arrange and say, okay, now it's fixed. We arranged this deal. No, not at all. I am is breathless awareness. I have never existed. I don't know. breathless awareness. I am is breathless oneness. Now, today was a ridiculous day in California, 83 degrees, even hotter over at the beach. Just like a scintillating day. Everybody's over at the beach. What am I doing? Taping. Sitting here, taping. Same thing with like practicing the piano. That everybody's out the dance halls and you know everything else. Where am I? Practicing, you know, 8 hours a day. And so later on in life, people say, "Wow, how'd you get so good? You know, you're lucky, huh?" I said, "No." When you were out, you know, dancing, I was out practicing. I was in practicing. And of course, they never believe that. It's not, it's just luck. It's luck. This is the problem, isn't it? When you succeed, nobody will believe you. When you say, you know, they'll just say it's luck. It's like the Giants, San Francisco Giants. Being a fan, was it 53 years, going on 54 years? They won it the first time, everyone says, fluke. Fluke, complete fluke. Won it the second time, luck. Really lucky. That's all it is luck. Now they've won it the third time, and they're saying, it's illegitimate. Got in as a wild card, that doesn't count. What do you mean? You have to play one extra game? Yeah, but it just, you know, didn't have a good enough season. It shouldn't count. We don't like the wild card, it shouldn't count. So, fluke, luck. Doesn't really shouldn't count, you know. This, you're never going to get the you know. See, this is how it is. When you're successful, really successful, people will dismiss you. It's luck. It's luck. Because they don't want to admit that somebody has outworked them, that someone has had a plan that requires dedication. That it's a total organizational accomplishment, because they think that's too much. They say, "No, I don't really want to do that." So it's easier just to say it's lucky. It's lucky. But you know, you make your own luck. You make your own luck. It's determination is what it is. It's vision, determination, perseverance, commitment. Never say die. Never get down. Bounce back. Play hard. Never panic. Believe, you know, all this stuff. And support, total organizational support. Smooth functioning. Everyone is mutually confident and supportive. All of that, you see, it's all of that. It's all of that. Plus great fan support. Great subcultural fan support. You know, the whole thing is what brings success. The entire enchilada is what brings the success. So, on the spiritual path, you know, it's the totality. It's the great teachers. It's the great teachings. It's your great effort. It's the Holy Spirit. It's the miracles. It's your determination. You know, it's everything. Never say die. Don't give up. Patience, perseverance, ice-breaking capability, pushing the buttons, pushing yourself into this jitteriness, you know, all of this, everydayness, the entire situation. Luck is not in play at all. Following the inner guidance. And yet, you know, when you succeed, people will just say, you're just born that way, you're just lucky. They won't accept it. Very few will accept it. Some will. For example, the Giant fans know what a great accomplishment 3 World Series in 5 years is. They know that they've been through like how many years of misery, of not winning. You know, half a century or more of not winning. Was it 54 to 2000 to 56 years? 56 years of futility. 56 years. And I went through about, you know, 48, 49 years of futility, of disappointment. 49 years of disappointment I went through before they finally won. So, we know, you know, the lean times, and we know, so we understand it is a great accomplishment. It was a result of tremendous momentum, tremendous positive momentum, tremendous, great, great job. But most people in the country, no way, just dismiss it, dismiss it. Few people, smart people, really super smart, who understand, they say, no, this is not to be dismissed. It's not luck. It's not luck. But they're in the minority. So when you are comfortable with the non-dual nature, original nature, I am is breathless awareness, there will be a few, some, will say, you know what, this isn't luck. This is fantastic. This is great. I want to study this. I want to see, you know, I want to do it too. But most people will simply say, no, it's just a fluke. Just a fluke. It's fluke, luck, illegitimate, nothing to see here, let's move on, like that. That's how it'll be. Continuity fear. Continuity fear. 100% continuity fear. Oh, they will, you know, they'll just put it into some idealistic format or something, distort it, confuse it, and say, oh, okay, maybe I can handle it that way. Well, what can we do? Nothing we can do about that. And of course, they will say, well, do it again. You know, it's the same thing with the Giants. Well, if you win next year, maybe, you know, maybe we'll give you some credit. And then if you win next year, they'll say, you got real lucky here. And, you know, not maybe you win again. You win 10 times in a row, they'll still say, you just got really, really lucky. And, you know, the competition wasn't good enough. And they just keep making excuses, just making excuses. Basically, they're lazy. They say, we don't want to work so hard. We want it just given to us, you know. Because they'll say, well, someone just gave it to you, because that's what they want, right? So if you're in the non-dual bite, and someone will say, your teacher just gave it to you or something, because that's what they want. They don't want to put in the effort. They say, no, I'm too busy gorging my senses, you know. I'm not going to stop doing that. If you got something for me, just give it to me. It's just like, give me a nice meal or something. That's it. So they will not go along. You know, they'll just say, no, it's luck. Someone gave it to you. Someone just gave it to you. So they dream of some teacher who's just going to say, here you go, give it to you. Say, okay, great. Doesn't work that way. Never works that way. If that was the case, Jesus would have given it to everybody and it'd be done. It would already been done a long time ago. Doesn't work. He said, no, none of you guys, apostles, understand what I'm talking about, really. You really need a lot of work before you can get what I'm saying. And he comes back almost 2,000 years later and says, hey, you still got a lot of work ahead of you. Get to it. Get to it. So blessed are those who get to it. And the rest of them, eventually again, they'll be the fat cats on the top of the tree. Say, oh my God, how do I get down? Try to jump, I can't jump. And then they're going to lose their confidence. At that point, they will sing a different tune. Okay, so they will sing a very different tune. stars, they're all saying, hey, we can fulfill. No, come down. Why do we have to come? We got music up here and dancing and food and everything. We got, that's great up here. We're having a party up on the top of the tree here. They don't ever have to go down. That's how the world goes. The people, they think, no, we can fulfill this inner emptiness by music or something, right? This is the problem. I mean, everyone demanded of me that I fill this inner emptiness they have with great music. It's a terrible demand. So I did the very best I could, and it didn't work. And then I started feeling like I'm a failure. I have to work harder at it. I should be able to do it. You see, I didn't understand what this emptiness really was. And of course, after the world presents this demand in a very beautiful goddess-like way, saying, my children are so thirsty for your, you know, to be filled with beauty. Please, can you help my children? You'd be so blessed. You'll be such a blessed saint if you help my children, you know. And eventually say, oh, okay, yeah, I think this is the way to salvation. You can save them. They're so, you know, their hearts are so anguished and full of pain and suffering. Can you not provide them with such beautiful music and beauty, and this will lighten their load and their souls, and they will feel them. This is the muse, this is the goddess, this is the clever sales lady that this demand, the world's craving, sends to you psychically and hooks you. It's the hooker, you know, for this what doesn't work. And, you know, it has to be a very, very clever, seductive hooker. Because you, within you, you feel like, you know, maybe this doesn't work. Maybe you get the feeling like, I don't think this is right. And so your resistance has to be worked on. And then you feel like, okay, I'll do my very best, because this wonderful goddess is asking me to provide her children with beauty. And I know I have, so maybe if I work really hard, I can do it, you know. It's absolutely horrible. Literally. You must turn your back on that. Absolutely turn your back on that. Which is why I say quiet. Quiet, quiet. Do not be an artistically creative. Do not try to fill this inner emptiness with artistic creativity. This is a disaster. A disaster. History is littered with horrible cases, and I was certainly one of them. As bad as it gets. Because the goddess is a vicious taskmaster. Work will work you to death because it doesn't work for her children. Her children are getting restive, saying, hey, you're promising us this, and then she turns to you and demands, you better, you know, you gotta come through with this, or you're gonna just fail everybody and you'll be the worst, wickedest person in the world. And so you just get driven with guilt, terrible guilt, and you have to try harder and harder to make, you know, it's hideous, it's horrible, absolutely horrible. Finally you wise up, thank God for Jesus Christ. Thank God for Jesus Christ, who is not deceived in the slightest bit by this. You look at the great teachers throughout history, how many of them spent their time trying to create beauty? Ramana Maharshi sat there in this incredible, awesome, quiet. Thank God for Ramana Maharshi. Sri Sri Anandamayi, the same. She didn't do anything creative. Neither one of them did. Longchenpa, same. Same, same. Jesus Christ, the same. Buddha, the same. You see. And others too. I'll let others from other traditions comment on those, you know. But you know, it's the same, same, isn't it? The same. They're not trying to fulfill our emptiness by some kind of artistic expression. Avoid that like the plague. Avoid that like the plague. Worse than the plague. That will never, never satisfy us. Only the spiritual path satisfies us and ultimately brings us to I am, is breathless awareness. breathless awareness of I am isness. Isness, the breathless awareness being brought, only that satisfies us, only that. So as a musician, you're competing with that. It's completely futile, completely futile. And the ones who urge you on, and you know, they're deceivers. Of course, they're projections based on our continuity fear. The goddess is a projection based on our continuity fear. The hooker that tries to convince us to do this is our own continuity fear. It's a projection. And of course, we will make her seem irresistible, because we feel that this will, you know, will save us somehow, but it doesn't. We're so frightened of our perfection that we're willing to waste our lives on, you know, frivolous stuff. I mean, music is frivolous, let's be honest. And I can produce as good as music as anyone if I really had to, you know, and I have done. Not so much in this life. I tried to, you know, keep doing it, but it didn't work. It didn't work. It didn't work. But certainly, I could do it easy. But it's like nothing. Totally frivolous. Totally frivolous. Everything we do in this world is totally frivolous. Even poetry is totally frivolous. All art is totally frivolous. Absolutely, totally frivolous. Which is why you see in you know, religious, spiritual cultures, all that stuff is, you know, forget it. Don't waste your time. Thank God for such cultures. If you find yourself one of those cultures, you're very, very blessed. Don't waste your opportunity. And don't waste your time in disputation. You don't get to the truth by arguing. Who has the stronger argument? Who can defeat others in argument and debate and dispute and all stuff? That doesn't work. That doesn't work. That kind of, part of that comes from basic, you know, this is one of the big problems in the world, is thinking that's how we, that's what, that somehow we'll be satisfied if someone wins an argument. No, no, absolutely not. Example is rabbinical tradition, which is heavily founded on, you know, back and forth dialogue and disputing and trying to arrive, you know. That's legalism. That's not going to satisfy anyone. That's pharisaical. You know, legalism, which Jesus said, doesn't work. Jesus denounced the Pharisees. Just keep in mind, the Sadducees, you know, they were on the way out anyway, but the Pharisaical culture continued as rabbinicalism. And has a very strong influence on the world in general, in terms of the idea of we can arrive at what satisfies us through dialogue, compromise, argumentation, discussion, all this kind of, that will never satisfy us. It's a false path. Void, empty of satisfaction. So only moving your comfort zone. This is the life well lived. Productive life. That's it. Nothing else is a productive life. Nothing else is a productive life. You could be the greatest artist in the world. You could be selling the most albums in history. Complete waste of time. Totally frivolous. And you just look at these artists today who are like selling top sellers and just ask yourself, do I want to be like them? Or, you know, the answer is not in a million years. Are you kidding? Those poor souls, you know, they think they're on top of the world. They're nowhere. One day they'd be willing to trade every ounce of success and accomplishment they ever had. They'll repudiate it all. They will absolutely repudiate it all, as I have done. With all the success I had previously, all my lifetimes, I repudiated everything. It's nothing. No accomplishment. And guess what? Reality does not need any accomplishment. reality is not in need of something being accomplished. Again, all praise to Jesus Christ. He brought the goods, you know, he brought the truth. Pointed out the situation. Not afraid to tell us, hey, this stuff will never satisfy. So, cut back on the frivolous stuff. Now, of course, you're so used to it. You know, going cold turkey, sometimes that works for a while. It did for me, like television, the Holy Spirit said, go cold turkey, you got to. So I did. I did, and it broke the spell of television, broke the spell. Never ever went back to it. So 1 year, never turned it on, paid any attention, not even once. Broke the spell, and then after that, just a little golf, a little bit. But, you know, I mute the commercials, don't even look at commercials. Minimize it to a large extent. Spell is broken. So often on the path, you'll go through like a cold turkey phase with something and you'll break the spell. You know, the grip is broken. Once it's broken, then, you know, take it from there. And usually you'll stay away from it, minimize it, stay away from it. Same with movies. I broke the spell of movies. I used to watch 6 movies a day. I watched hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of movies. And then I just felt like, okay, that's it. Never watched a movie since. I may watch a video on YouTube, some documentary or whatever, sort of an amateur, like the amateur sort of stuff, sort of. But no movies, you know, no. Spell was broken, totally broken. Never went back. So you may have this cold turkey situation where you say, you know what, I just really need to stay away from this and not put my attention on it at all and commit to it. And eventually you will find, my gosh, I realize I don't need that. So that's very important, that maybe you have something in your life that you're going cold turkey on, all right? So just keep that going, keep it going. You can do it for a year or so, absolutely. Let the Holy Spirit guide you. Maybe it'd be like no music for a year. Break the spell of music, you know, upon you. No entertainment for a year. Or maybe like you read too many spiritual books. No spiritual books for a year, I don't know. But whatever you do, quiet, silent, give yourself time to sit. Push the buttons to stun mind. Staggered mind. Move your comfort zone. I would say do it every day. Don't stop doing that. All right, so let's just open the book up, and Jesus will say something, journey beyond words. And that is all. Truly, that is all. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. And that is all. Truly, that is all. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. It's right there. And you would at once cease to believe any of the things your senses seem to tell you. And that will be the leap of faith which I speak. This is not a condemnation, for you are independent of whatever you might think or define. The most holy Son of God, the most free, the most undefined, the most love being you can imagine. It will not pass away because you have fought it or struggled against it. It will pass away because you have simply let it go. And you will not have let it go, and you will not have let go of your fear through struggle, but you will have let it go because you have chosen something more precious. Indeed, something that is worth valuing. Again, it will not pass away because you have fought it or struggled against it. It will pass away because you have simply let it go. You will not have let go of your fear through struggle, but you will have let it go because you have chosen something more precious, indeed something that is worth valuing. Straight from the teacher. Straight from the teacher. Fabulous. Absolutely fabulous. And when I speak of your one self, I am only iterating that there is no separation anywhere in all of creation. That there is no separation anywhere in all of creation. And this refers to, again, the arising, the subsiding, the non-arising, and the non-subsiding are all one. There is no separation. They're not separate functioning. All right. This is just the one functionality of pure potential. As I know myself in truth, so do I know you. And I have come here to share with you this day and the other days, in order that you may come to see yourself as I see you, and that you may see all your brothers as I see them. So we speak of learning this course, which is beyond learning, and of moving to a point at which your will is God's will. Now perhaps you can, in your thinking, get a glimmer of understanding of what I have meant. But perhaps more, if you let your thoughts be still for a moment, you will feel, at a quiet point within, the awareness that truly you are your brother. The true idol you worship, which is your ego, is your belief that to be separate, to be alone, is somehow desirable. That belief is what has caused this entire illusion you call your world. If you could know within yourself, at the level of experience, the joy, the fullness, and the beauty that comes from the oneness we share, then in an instant, in the twinkling of an eye, your life would be totally changed. And you would never court this illusion of isolation again. And in that instant, when you truly perceive what you are, anything eyes and before the eyes of others, and the world will again say, a miracle. Therefore, your only goal is to accept the atonement for yourself. Of that we have spoken before. As you follow the voice within, you shall be free of this world. In your stillness of thought, you shall hear it, and as you in your time learn more and more to be still, the voice shall become louder and louder, and it shall become more and more clear to you what to do, what to say, what to be, and where to go. You may wish to simply try to keep saying that to yourself in words. Then a time may come when you shall realize it and experience it within your being. Greetings again. I am Yeshua. I have come this day to further with you my discussion of A Course in Miracles. You are not what you seem. This I have been saying to you in many forms these many weeks. This earth, this world does not accurately tell you of what you are. That which you see with your eyes, hear with your ears, and touch with your senses is not a representation of you. That which you perceive based on those senses does not tell you of what you are. So indeed, a major illusion of this world is your concept of who you are, and once formed, it seems to you that if that concept meets with change, you, at least in part, must die. Thus you cling to these few meaningless thoughts about who you are, as if to defend them with your very life. But you do not have the power to create fear within God itself, or to create the death of God, or to cause God to be in any sense separate from His creations. Your belief in what this world is, all of your belief in what you should do, and therefore your belief in choice itself, I have told you not to value the things of this world, for they are not part of you. And if they do not have to do with you, and they do not have to do with you, your true nature as the Son of God. In the holy instant, there is no past, and of course then, no sin and no guilt. There is no future, and of course then, no fear. And in freedom, knowing that you shall never be alone, truly, as I said 2,000 years ago, and which is still true today, and which shall be true for all of your time, I shall not leave you comfortless. Blessings, blessings upon you all. That is all. So, without trying to evaluate any of that, but simply hearing it, without trying to measure your acceptance of it or non-acceptance of it, simply allow yourself to be shaken up by it. Be disturbed by it, to be staggered by it. You know, we're listening to Jesus right there. See, that's really something. That's really, okay, 1 second. So, this is something to stagger the mind, okay? We are listening to Jesus right there. The breeze of transmission. Don't evaluate how much of it you get, how much of it you don't get. Just say, wow, that's very staggering. And be grateful for the staggering. Be grateful for this breeze that staggers us. Above all else, be grateful for the breeze that staggers the mind so we can make progress in moving our comfort zone. Above all else. Okay, very great. Time to go to church now and see how that turns out. Very great. That's it.